the requirement of the question, let's discuss it first. So we have to calculate the consolidated goodwill at 1st October 2013. This is the date of acquisition. And then we have to prepare a consolidated profit and loss account and other comprehensive income for the year ended March 2014. Now you have to be careful about that. What is the date of acquisition? It might be the case of the mid-year acquisition. So we should know the date of acquisition. So if profit and loss account for the year is 31st March 2014 and the date of acquisition is 1st October 13, then this is a period of 6 months. So that means you have to consolidate subsidiaries, profit and loss account and other comprehensive income for a period of 6 months only. That is the mid-year acquisition. Now let's discuss the detail of the question. Keeping in mind, first of all, we have to calculate goodwill. So in order to calculate goodwill, what you need? In order to calculate goodwill, you need cost of investment by parent company. You need fair value of NCI at acquisition and fair value of net asset of subsidiary at acquisition. So on 1st October 2013, this is the date of acquisition. P acquired 90 million shares out of 150 million. First of all, we have to calculate the percentage that how much shares have been acquired. So it says that 90 out of 150. So the percentage of holding is 90 out of 150, and that is 60% holding by parent company. So NCI holding is 40%. This is the group structure, the basic group structure. So the acquisition was through a share exchange of one for every three acquired in subsidiary. So it means that we have to find out the number of shares issued by a parent company. So parent company has acquired 90 million shares through a share exchange. And parent company issued one for every three. So one for every three, that means 90 million shares acquired. And against three, the parent company issued one shares. That means 30 million shares being issued by the parent company. So parent company has issued 30 million shares. Now we have to identify the value of 30 million shares and for which we need to have the share price of parent company's share. At the date, the stock price of P was 4 and the stock price of S was 2.5. So we need to have market price of parent company's share. So the value of shares is 30 million number of shares issued multiplied by 4 is equal to 120 million USD. This is the investment cost against the issuance of shares. Additionally, P will pay 1.54 cash on 30th September 2014 for each shares acquired. 90 million shares has been acquired and the payment will be made on cash, but on deferred terms, that is on 30th September 2014 after 1 year. So the payment, the cash consideration, if you can find out the cash consideration, it will be 1.54 per acquired shares and number of shares acquired is 90 million. So what you will pay against this 90 million multiplied by 1.54 and that is 138.6 million. But this is after 1 year. So we need to find out the present value of 138.6 million and for which we need a discount rate, and the discount rate given is 10%, and the discount factor for 10% rate is 0.909. You can check it with the table or you can directly use the formula. So PV is 138 future value multiplied by the discount factor, and it will give us a figure of the present value, and that is 0.909, that is 125.9 million. You can round it off, and that is 126 million. This is the present value of cash consideration. So the total investment comprises of shares and cash consideration is 246 million. This is the starting value that we have to consider. So this is the cost of investment. Now for NCI, I have been given some information about NCI in the last point number 5. P's policy is to value NCI at fair value. For this purpose, the share price of subsidiary is representative of the fair value of shares held by the NCI. So the NCI value is not given. So we have to calculate the value of NCI at acquisition, and for which I have to use a formula, value of NCI, that is number of shares held by NCI multiplied by share price of subsidiary, not parent company. So out of 150 million, 40% is being held by NCI, and the share price of subsidiary is 2.5. In this way, the value would be 1,50,000. So it's 150 into 0.4 multiplied by 2.5, that is 150 million. Now, one thing is very important is that if you find out the present value of the cash consideration, do remember that there will be an unwinding of discount, and that unwinding will be charged to finance cost in the consolidated profit and loss account. Now, after finding this out, let's discuss the other information. The retained earning of subsidiary brought forward at 1st April was 120 million. Now the problem is that the acquisition date is 1st October 2013, but we have been provided with the retained earning of subsidiary 6 months back, that is 1st April 2013. So this is a hurdle, that how to calculate the retained earning at the date of acquisition. So we have to consider the after-tax profit for which time apportionment is needed. The summarized statement of profit and loss and other comprehensive income for the year ended March for the full year is given below. Revenue, cost of sales, gross profit, distribution, admin, investment income. This is an important adjustment. Intra-group dividend might be. Finance cost, PBT, income tax. Again, a difficult adjustment. Gain on loss on revaluation. You can see in the parent's books, there is a revaluation deficit. And in the subsidiary books, there is a revaluation surplus of 3,000. Now, additional information, what it says, a fair value exercise, that is a fair value adjustment on 1st October conducted, conclude that the carrying amount of net asset of subsidiary were equal to fair value, having some exceptions. Number one, the fair value of land was 2 million in excess of its carrying amount. So we have to make a adjustment of fair value adjustment of land. An item of plant having a fair value of 6 million in excess, and the remaining life of the plant was 2 years at the date of acquisition. Depreciation is to be charged in cost of sales. P placed a value of 5 million on good trading relationship with its customer. The subsidiary has a customer relationship, good customer relationship, which cannot be recognized in the individual balance sheet, but parent has placed a value of 5 million. So that could be a part of the fair value adjustment. On average, a customer relationship lasts for a further 5 years. So we have to amortize this particular value, and it is to be charged in admin expense. So these three are the fair value adjustment. Now we are in a position to calculate the fair value adjustment at acquisition. So fair value of net assets at acquisition. So first of all, we need to calculate the share capital of subsidiary. So share capital is 150 million, 150 shares, and par value is 1. There is no premium given. So we have to just focus on the retained earning side. So the retained earning at 1st April, 6 month back, brought forward is given as this one, 120 million. Take this, 120 million. And now add profit after tax of 6 month of subsidiary. So profit after tax, take profit after tax, not the total comprehensive income. So profit after tax is 80,000. So 80,000 multiply by 6 by 12 will give you a figure of 40, and that shows that the retained earning is total 140 million. So we have 160 million. So we have 160 million of retained earning, and then we have the fair value adjustment. The fair value adjustment, first one is land. The excess of land is 2 million. Then the plant, the excess of plant is 6 million. And then trading relationship and intangible asset. And that is 5 million. So total, if you can find out, 310 and it's 13. So the total is 3,23,000 or 323 million. So this is the fair value of net assets. Now let's calculate the goodwill at acquisition. So for goodwill, we need to have cost of investment working. So cost of investment is, I've calculated this, 246 million. Is it the cost of investment? Yes, 246 million. Then fair value of NCI at acquisition, that is 150 million. Then deduct fair value of net asset at acquisition of subsidiary, that is 323 million. So we have the positive goodwill at acquisition, and this value is 73,000. Is the goodwill, or you can say that 73 million. As the data is given in thousands, so we have to calculate it in thousand as well. So this is the first requirement. Now we have to prepare a consolidated income statement in which there is a mid-year acquisition case. So we'll consider 100% value of P, parent company, and subsidiary 6 by 12 because of the mid-year acquisition. So let's start preparing the consolidated income statement and other comprehensive income. We have to see the adjustment as well. But first of all, let me just prepare the pro forma. There are some adjustments like intra-group trading and intra-group dividend. So it's other comprehensive income for the year ended 31st March. And this is 31st March 2014. So first of all, we need consolidated revenue, consolidated COGS, consolidated gross profit, and in the question, distribution and admin cost. It's distribution cost. There is an administration cost. Investment income. I have left something for it might be an associate. Finance cost. There is profit before tax, so we have to adjust tax, and then we have profit for the year, and then we have other comprehensive income, and there is either revaluation surplus or revaluation deficit, and that this become total comprehensive income. So this is the consolidated total comprehensive income, and then we have to attribute this particular income statement. We have to attribute the share of NCI profit attribution as well as the TCI attribution. So let me just leave some space and I'll start working of income statement here. So let's find out the notes. I have to calculate depreciation on plant. So let's identify depreciation on plant. We have plant 6 million. We have plant, excess value of plant was 6 million and the remaining life was 2. So it's 6 million divided by 2 multiplied by 6 by 12. So the value of depreciation comes out to be, the excess value of depreciation comes out to be 1.5 million. And it's 1,500. Then we have amortization of trading relationship. And the trading relationship value was excess 5 million and the remaining life was 5 years. So it was 5 million into 6 by 12, that is 500 or 0.5 million. Now, the next information is Peace Group's policy is to revalue land to market value at the end of each accounting period. It is the parent's policy to revalue the assets land at market value. So subsidiary has to follow that. Prior to its acquisition, subsidiary's land had been valued at historical cost, but it adopted the group policy since after acquisition. In addition to the fair value increase in land, it had increased the land by further 1 million. So it means that the land overall increased by 3 million. And you can see that here it's 3 million. Now, the next point is, on 1st October 2013, at the date of acquisition, P also acquired 30% shares of Ventor. After-tax profit of Ventor was 10 million. And during March, that is after acquisition, Ventor paid a dividend of 6 million. P used equity method of accounting in its consolidated financial statement of Ventor. Subsidiary did not pay any dividend in the year ended 31st March 2014. And now let's discuss the case of associate. Ventor is an associate. So we have 30% shares in Ventor and profit after tax of Ventor has been given. It's 10 million and there is a dividend of 6 million. Profit after tax is 10 million and dividend paid by Ventor is 6 million. Now, what is the meaning of equity method of accounting? When we say that equity method of accounting, in equity method of accounting, we find out the income from associate. Again, it's a mid-year acquisition case. So we have to calculate income from associate. And we'll calculate from the profit after tax. Profit after tax is 10 million. But time apportionment, because of the mid-year acquisition and the share of parent company, this will give us a figure of exactly 1.5 million. So this is 1500. This is part of income statement, income from associate. So let me just write it down. One more value, that is income from associate. Now you can see that in the question there is a dividend income, that is investment income, of 5000. So from in 5000 there is a dividend received from associate, and the dividend received from associate is a cancelling item. So how much is the dividend received from associate? It is to be cancelled out from the income statement. So the subsidiary has paid a dividend of 6 million. What is the share of parent company? So out of 6 million, the parent will get 30%, that is 1800. So from the available, whatever is the dividend, we will deduct the intra-group elimination. So it is intra-company and it is to be eliminated. So remember that intra-group dividend from subsidiary and intra-group dividend from associate, both are to be eliminated, both are to be cancelled out. Now the next adjustment says that after acquisition, P sold, parent company sold goods to subsidiary for 20 million. This is intra-group sales. Subsidiary had 1/5 of these goods in stock at March. And in March, P sold goods to associate. All the goods are inventory. And markup is 25%. So there is two intra-group sales. Now let's identify intercompany sales. First is from parent to subsidiary. Sales value, we have to identify the sales value. 20 million, 1/5 is in stock. And markup is 25%. So I have to calculate unrealized profit, PURP, provision of unrealized profit. And that is 20 million sales value, 125 multiplied by 25. This is profit multiplied by 1/5. And this will give me a figure of 20 divided by 125 multiplied by 25 divided by 5. So it's 0.8. So it's 0.8 million. What it means, 0.8 million. So this 0.8 million says that 800 is the adjustment. So I have to remove this from the cost of goods sold. So what I will do, I'll add it to COGS in order to remove the effect of 800. Similarly, I have to eliminate the intra-group sales from both sales and cost of goods sold. Now, parent to associate. The sales value given to us is 15 million. Sales is 15 million and the same markup is 25%. So PURP, in case of associate, you should know that in case of associate, we identify our share in associate. Right. So as a result, the 15 million divided by 125 multiplied by 25 multiplied by the share of parent company, and this will give you a figure of 900. This is again to be eliminated because the profit is in the stock of parent company. Profit is in the books of parent company. So we have to eliminate it as well. Now all these adjustments have been done, and now we need to incorporate these values. So in case of revenue, take parent company's revenue, that is 620, full 620,000. Plus 310,000 of subsidiary into mid-year acquisition effect, minus intra-group sales between parent and subsidiary, and this is 20 million. That is 20,000. So this is the consolidated revenue, and that comes out to be 755,000. Now for COGS, let me put some working here. COGS. Parent COGS, then subsidiary COGS, then intra-group sales, or rather intra-group purchases, and PURP. And there will be depreciation on fair value adjustment as well. So as far as the parent company's cost of goods sold is concerned, it will be given in the question as 400,000. As far as subsidiary is concerned, it is given in the question as 150,000. So it's 150,000 into mid-year acquisition effect, that is 75,000. Intra-group purchases, parent and subsidiary, 20,000. PURP, one PURP is 800, other PURP is 900. So we have two PURP, 800 plus 900, 1700. So we have to add this in order to eliminate this. And depreciation on fair value adjustment, amortization is to be charged in admin expense. So depreciation is 1500. Depreciation is an expense, so it would be part of cost of goods sold. We have to add it to the cost of goods sold. As a result, we'll get a figure of 458,200. And this 458,200 is now part of 458,200. And as a result, the gross profit value is 296,800. Gross profit. Now take distribution profit, distribution expense. Parent 40,000, subsidiary 20,000. So it's parent 40,000, subsidiary is 20,000 multiplied by 6 by 12 plus the amortization. And what was the amortization? The amortization was, how we calculated the amortization. It's 500. So just take 500 amortization. So it's total would be, no, it's not in distribution, it is in admin. So we have to use this in admin. So it's 50,000 expense. And as far as the admin is concerned, admin is 36 plus 25. So we have 36,000 plus half of 25,000 and plus 500 of amortization. So as a result, the admin expense is 49,000. Now, investment income. So let's just calculate the working of investment income too. Investment income in the books of parent company given as 5,000, and in the books of subsidiary it's 1,600. So it's 5,000, and in the books of subsidiary it's 1,600. So in the case of mid-year acquisition, we took 6 by 12, 800, and eliminate dividend from associate. And that dividend from associate was, we have calculated above, the dividend from associate, that is 1500. Sorry, this is not dividend from associate, it's 1800. So deduct 1800 from this. So it's what is the value of investment income? It's 4,000. So 4,000 is the investment income. Income from associate. Income from associate is 1,500. Finance cost given is 2,000 and 5,600. 2,000 and 5,600. So take 2,000 plus 5,600 into 6 by 12, plus unwinding of discount. Now, how you can calculate unwinding of discount? Because we have future value, we have to consider the initial investment value. The present value was 1,26,000. So take 10% of this present value, 1,26,000, multiply by 10%, but for 6 months, it's 6 by 12. So it will be a figure of 11,100 finance cost. As a result, we have a PBT of 192,200. Tax figure, we can take it directly. And we have profit for the year is 131,700. Now, in case of revaluation, you can see that the revaluation of parent company is, there is a deficit, 2,200 deficit, and there is a overall 3,000 of surplus, but 2,000 of the surplus was at the date of acquisition. So the post period surplus is 1,000. So what we have to do is to just identify that how much is relevant for us. So minus 2,200 plus post period revaluation surplus. So it's post period revaluation surplus, that is 3,000 minus 2,000 in acquisition. So in this way, it's 1,200 of deficit, and total comprehensive income is 130,500. Now we have to attribute this to NCI. So profit attributable to parent company and profit attributable to NCI. So the total profit is 131,700. We have to find out NCI share in profit. So NCI share in profit, take profit after tax of subsidiary. So profit after tax from the original question says that it's 80,000. So 80,000 multiply by 6 by 12 parents percentage. Parent share was 60%, and that is 24,000. This is the easiest way and through which you can incorporate now the adjustment separately after identifying this. So we have depreciation on fair value adjustment and amortization. So we have depreciation on plant, that was 1500, and the NCI share was 40. So it's 600, and amortization was 500. NCI share 40%, that is 200. Now there is no unrealized profit adjustment. Why? Because the seller was subsidiary. So let me just took the value of 40% share. There is a mistake because I took 60%, and that is the parent's share, not the parent share. It is the NCI share, 40%. Let me just correct it. It's 16,000, and from 16,000, 800 is to be deducted. So that would be 15,200. Put it here, 15,200, and there would be a balance for parent company, and that balance is 116,500. Now also TCI attributable to parent company and NCI. So just put the revaluation surplus here, add revaluation surplus, and that post revaluation surplus was 1000. So the NCI share is 40%, and that is 400. So it becomes 15,600. Now give 15,600, and the parent's balancing figure would be 114,900. So in this way, the requirement of the question was that we have to calculate goodwill, and we have to calculate consolidated P&L and other comprehensive income. There are some fair value adjustment, cost of investment. We have to calculate NCI. So in this particular question, we have dealt with the intra-group trading between parent and subsidiary, between parent and associate. There is an intra-group dividend income from the associate, and depreciation adjustment, amortization adjustment, and also the unwinding of discount. So this is a good question for practicing a complete income statement.